good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am.
Thank you to Zach Logan for assisting with liturgy, and for Deanne and Ross for assisting with the videoing, and of course Heather for the organ. There's a lot of people that make this work, and we're thankful for each and every one of you. Reminder that we're still pending opening. We're thinking that the earliest date at this point might be July 12th. So please call the office, watch social media and the website and emails, and we'll be happy to let you know and keep you informed. We are pleased to be serving in this time and in this place. We continue with dinner together. We continue to send food to our Backpack Buddy kids and much, much more. So if you're interested in helping in any way, cooking, baking, there are lots of chores, fun stuff we can do. We'd love to have you get involved with us. So my friends, let us worship the Lord our God.
Today we celebrate. We celebrate dads everywhere. Those that taught us to ride our first bike, and those that worked endless hours so that we could go to school. We celebrate fathers that never had a chance to see their children, and those that tucked their kids into bed every night. We celebrate father figures that stepped in the gap when no one else did. And we celebrate God the Father, loving, forgiving, merciful, just, righteous. Let us worship the Lord our God.
You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are, and I'm loved by you.
I'd like to wish a happy Father's Day to Ron Harvey, the best dad in the world. From Stephanie and Brendan in Oxford, Ohio.
Oh, and I've seen
Happy Father's Day, Dad. Love you.
Happy Father's Day, Dad. You're awesome, and I'm very blessed. Love you.
We're all searching for answers. Only you
provide. Happy Father's Day. I love my daddy.
What we need before we say a word.
Happy Father's Day. I hope you have a great day. I love you. Can't wait to see you.
This is Ashley and Caleb in Arizona, and we just want to wish Ron Harvey a very happy Father's Day.
Happy Father's Day, Papa. We love you. Thank you so much for everything that you do.
Thank you. Love you.
Hi, Dad. Happy Father's Day. Love you.
Father's Day to all the dads out there. Couldn't imagine life without y'all. Have a good one. Happy Father's Day again.
Happy Father's Day, Dad. It's Debbie. And I enjoyed seeing you up at Hidden Springs the other day. And I was happy that you were being able to tell me all about your fun time that you had watching Flag Day up there. I'll be back to visit soon. But in the meantime, again, happy Father's Day. I love you, and I'm going to blow you a little kiss.
Happy Father's Day. Love you.
Teach me some.
that you join with me in our prayer of confession. God, Abba, Father, it is you that loves us with the love we cannot fathom, and we turn away, neglecting your wisdom, craving our own independence. Forgive us that we call you our Father, but fail to live as your children. We have returned your love by acting as spoiled children, yet still you have kept your blessing, you have kept blessing us beyond measure. We run from your presence, yet you still welcome us home. Remind us we are yours. Forgive us when we fail in loving you and others. And guide us in your way. Amen.
Come and fill our hearts with your peace. You alone, O Lord, are holy. Come and fill our hearts with your peace. Alleluia.
To just move around freely. I've been suffering from back pain, and I just feel thankful to be able to move around without a lot of pain today.
Yeah, move around, a little less back pain. Mm-hmm. Yeah, back pain will get you every time. Zach, what are you thankful for?
I've got a garden at home this summer, so I'm thankful for the rain.
Ah, me too. I just planted plants, and I'm not very good at watering them, so I get it. Heather, are you still in here? Ah, the gift of music. And I have to say, you've been doing a phenomenal job with the choir and getting different songs in. Thank you, Heather, for all your hard work over time and for our choir members being open to new possibilities. We've got choir members in a garage band now. Never thought they'd be in that. I have to say, I'm thankful because I am excited that my brother and sister-in-law get to come visit this weekend. And so Aaron and Jeff and their kids. And I'm just looking forward to a little family time and getting to see my nieces. So I'm thankful for that. We are going to talk in our children's message about how much God loves you and how much he knows about you. That so much so that if I look at your pictures, I see lots of you guys that have lots of hair. And in our scripture passage that Zach's going to read in a minute, he's going to say, God knows every hair on your head. That's pretty impressive because there's a lot of hair in these pictures. There's a whole lot of hair. Well, Maybe not with Andy. He's got his cut really short. But anyway, so I hope you'll join Rita and myself in our children's message, and let us pray. Lord, we thank you that you love us no matter where we are. We thank you that you know us so intimately, that you know each hair on our head. And we give thanks, Lord, that through your Son, Jesus Christ, we are loved beyond anything we can count. Amen.
Our first scripture lesson this morning comes from Matthew chapter 10, verses 24 through 39. A disciple is not above his master. Forgive me, not above his teacher, nor a servant above his master. It is enough for the disciple to be like his teacher and the servant like his master. If they have called the master of the house Beelzebul, how much more will they malign those of his household? So have no fear of them, for nothing is covered that will not be revealed, or hidden that will not be known. What I tell you in the dark, utter in the light, and what you hear whispered, proclaim upon the housetops. And do not fear those that kill the body, but cannot kill the soul. Rather, fear him who can destroy both soul and body in hell. Are not two sparrows sold for a penny? And not one of them will fall to the ground without your Father's will. But even the hairs on your head are all numbered. Fear not, therefore, you are of more value than many sparrows. So everyone who acknowledges me before men, I also will acknowledge before my Father who is in heaven. But whoever denies me before men, I will also deny before my Father who is in heaven. Do not think I have come to bring peace on earth. I have not come to bring peace, but a sword. For I have come to set a man against his father, and a daughter against her mother, and a daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. And a man's foes will be those of his own household. He who loves father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. And he who loves son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. And he who does not take his cross and follow me is not worthy of me. He who finds life will lose it, and he who loses life for my sake will find it.
Thank you.
interesting passage for Father's Day, that Jesus comes to divide. And I have to confess that the next scripture passage isn't one that sounds very fatherly either. But I'm reminded that the lectionary is God's word to us through the scriptures, and Father's Day is a Hallmark holiday. So I still think God works through it for us. So just to add to that, father against son and mother and against daughter-in-law, we're going to read from Genesis chapter 21, a horror story. And it is the story of Hagar and Ishmael. Now, if you remember your history in Genesis, Abraham and Sarah were promised a son that would be the beginning of the entire covenant, and Sarah is barren, and so she can't carry a son, so she gives Hagar to Abraham to carry the son. She gives birth to Ishmael. Ishmael then grows up, and Sarah becomes pregnant and gives birth to Isaac. And Isaac is the child of the promise. And at this point in our story, what has happened is that Isaac is being, there's a feast in his honor. And Sarah and Hagar do not have the best relationship, which I can't imagine would be good in any cases. So at this point, we are hearing about Hagar and Ishmael. The child grew, that's Isaac, and was weaned. And Abraham made a great feast on the day that Isaac was weaned. But Sarah saw the son of Hagar the Egyptian, whom she had borne to Abraham, playing with her son Isaac. So she said to Abraham, "Cast out this slave woman with her son, for the son of this slave woman shall not inherit along with my son Isaac." The matter was very distressing to Abraham on account of his son. But God said to Abraham, "Do not be distressed because of the boy and because of your slave woman. Whatever Sarah tells you to do, do as she says, for it is through Isaac that offspring shall be named for you. As for the son of the slave woman, I will make a nation of him also, because he is your offspring." So Abraham rose early in the morning, took bread and a skin of water, and gave it to Hagar, putting it on her shoulder along with the child, and sent her away. And she departed and wandered about in the wilderness of Beersheba. When the water in the skin was gone, she cast the child under one of the bushes. Then she went and sat down opposite him a good way off, about the distance of a bow shot. For she said, "Do not let me look on the death of the child." And as she sat opposite him, she lifted up her voice and wept. And God heard the voice of the boy. And the angel of God called to Hagar from heaven and said to her, "What troubles you, Hagar? Do not be afraid. For God has heard your voice of the boy where he is. Come, lift up the boy and hold him fast with your hand, for I will make a great nation of him." Then God opened her eyes, and she saw a well of water. She went and filled the skin with water and gave the boy a drink. God was with the boy, and he grew up. He lived in the wilderness and became an expert with the bow. He lived in the wilderness of Paran, and his mother got a wife for him from the land of Egypt. The prophet Isaiah says, "The grass withers and the flower fades, but the word of our Lord will stand forever." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. So we go to God in prayer today. We have much to lift up to him. With all of the issues in our community, we pray for peace. And yet, as Zach shared in the gospel lesson, peace does not come easily. So that's why we pray, "Come, Lord Jesus, come." We pray for health and community as we continue to walk through this pandemic. And we pray for each one of you, that you continue to find that spiritual blessing that you may have thought was only present in the church, but now is present in your homes. Let us pray. Lord, you would have us call you Father. You would have us call you by all sorts of names, Redeemer, Sustainer. You have taught us that you are the gate, that you are the bread of life, that you are the God who sees. And so, Lord, as we think about all these different names we have for you, the many different ways you reach out into fellowship with us to build relationship, we also recognize that in each one of those, we have turned and gone about our own path. And we ask for your forgiveness. Like little children first starting to walk, Lord, we may tentatively begin to walk away, but once we see something glimmering in the corner, we run. And yet you still have not forgotten us. And you, O Lord, are more than willing to bend down on one knee, open your arms, and welcome us home. And that is a love that we try to understand, but we cannot grasp it in our lives. The love of a father to his children. A love that always welcomes them home despite their choices. The love of a father who loves children that may not be his by blood, but by his by the fact that he has been given them to care for them. We give you thanks, Lord. We give you thanks for all of the fathers that are off in other corners of the world fighting for our freedom and leaving their children home thinking of a better life, a better dream, so that they might grow up and simply be. We thank you, Lord, for fathers that hardly ever see their children. Because they're working long hours, because they don't get a chance to, for all the many reasons, Lord, bless them this day and all days. And we ask you in your mercy, Lord, to be with us as a community. May we seek to support all parents in whatever walk of life they are in. May we seek to judge less and love more. May we seek to reach into those children's lives that do not have a father figure and offer to them the mentor and the love that you give to us as God the Father. And in this time and in this place, Lord, we pray urgently. Our prayers are ringing up from every corner of our nation and countries worldwide because we don't have peace. And we are terrified and frightened for what might come. We are sorrowful for what has happened. And we seek restoration so that we can move ahead. So, Lord, be with everybody that struggles with the issues of today. Lord, in your mercy, be with our police force as they seek to build communities. Lord, be with all of our communities, black, white, homosexual, transgendered, Hispanic, whatever, Lord. Be with each one of us so that we might celebrate our own unique identity while not taking away from someone else's. For you, Lord, have created us all equal in your sight. Lord, may your mercy be on our community as we continue to walk in unpathed ways that we have no clue what to do with COVID and all that's going on, Lord, may you be the great physician that you have told us you are so that you might rain down your healing powers on the hospitals and nursing homes and prisons and homes so that we might find a way that we can join again in fellowship. We give you thanks, Lord, for this church. For the ways in which they serve, for the ways in which this church loves and goes beyond the walls that have previously contained us. And we ask you, Lord, to bless all of those that are serving and those that are served. May we only serve to plant a seed that you might grow. For it is through your Son's holy and precious name that we ask this and all things. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. As I mentioned, the story of Hagar and Ishmael is really not a great Father's Day message. Hagar and Ishmael speak of Abraham who tosses his son out into the wilderness. What in the world are we doing? And we're going to get to this because I think it's important, and I mentioned this in prayer, the many names we have for God. And I have many names. We all go by different names. Start thinking. I'm going to ask if you guys have a nickname. So start thinking, Zach and Deanne. I have quite a few. My father and my pop-pop call me Dinks. Don't even know where it came from, but I love it. I'm also wife and mother and sister and aunt. My given name is Caroline, but I go by Carrie. My kids call me Mom. My favorite niece and nephew call me Aunt Carrie. And unbeknownst to many of you, my friends in my neighborhood call me Bad Carrie. That's a story for another day. Zach, what are some of your nicknames?
I can't repeat them.
Oh, okay. Can't be repeated in the house of the Lord. Deanne, do you have any nicknames?
We discussed this last week.
Yes, you did. Sparky.
Sparky.
Yes. I love that one. That's kind of fun. Shows you have gumption. My favorite nickname that I've ever, I love when kids come up with nicknames for their parents and grandparents. And I have a friend who's Norwegian, and her children call their grandparents, her grandmother, Bestemor, which in Norwegian means best of all mothers, which I love. I think that's pretty cool. My kids chose their names for their grandparents. When we were in Charlotte, I'd be on the phone with my mother, and Paul would say, who's on the phone? I'd say, my mom. Jacob calls her my mom, because he thought that was her name. And unbeknownst to us, and we have no clue where it came from, Jacob started calling my dad Big Daddy, which was not the name my dad would have chosen. And when I was pregnant with Isabel, he said, if this one comes out a girl, my name will not be Big Daddy. Good luck. Now all of her friends call him Big Daddy too. Names tell a story. And I love that. And in scripture, we're not actually given a name for God. We're given, God says, I am that I am to Moses. But we're not really given a name for God because it also allows us to define him. And defining God is something we can't really do. But back to Hagar and Ishmael, an odd text for Father's Day. To read of a story of a father who abandons his son and slave woman into the wilderness, and if you thought, well, maybe, Carrie, you should have jumped ahead and swapped the scripture for next week. Next week, the lectionary talks about Abraham and Isaac. So now we're kicking them out. Next week, we're talking about Isaac being sacrificed on an altar. Happy Father's Day, guys. But there's a message in here. Many people find themselves in this story. Many people find themselves shut out, lost in a wilderness that they can't define, calling on a God they cannot name. The story of Hagar and Ishmael in Genesis 21, as I mentioned, goes back, and I told you kind of a little bit of the backstory, but it is a story of God's love and promise that even as barren Sarah gave birth to Isaac, Hagar and Ishmael have a promise as well. And we talk about this story, and of course it's when Isaac is weaned, and Ishmael is there, and they're playing together, and Sarah was mad. So she sends them away. Get out of here. Abraham first, he says, wait, God, I don't, and then he gives in. A little wishy-washy there. Maybe not the father that we want to look up to. We might expect that because scripture tells us that Isaac is the son of the promise, it is through him that the covenant will be made, we might expect at this point to never hear from Hagar and Ishmael again. They're not part of our story. But surprisingly, the narrative tells us what happens next. Surprisingly, God tells us a message of something beyond our own individual reality, our own individual promise, and I think that's important. It tells us that even though Abraham has shunned them and sent them out, God has not. Death is imminent for them. She puts Ishmael under a tree a little ways away so that she doesn't have to hear his cries when he dies. And God reveals God's self to Hagar. We are left to acknowledge that there may be outsiders beyond the bounds of our main story. Your story is different than my story. Zach and Deanne's stories are different. But our story as Christians, as the people of God, is one. This tells us that God still cares for those that are outside of our story, providing them water and blessing them even when it's unexpected. So this is a story in the midst of real life, in the midst of our life. And the people in this story are just as broken as each one of us is. Abraham is a patriarch who's easily swayed. Sarah seems actually desperate, competitive, and vindictive, and conceited. Hagar goes from being all of this arrogance to I have the son to then being the abused woman sent out into the wilderness. But God does not change. God remains constant, not just to us, but to all those he loves. And it's dangerous at this point in the story, very dangerous, to say as Christians, that's a great story. But Hagar and Ishmael were sent away outside of the promise and God took care of them anyway. So the danger is, like Abraham, we might just walk away and say, not my story, not my problem, and sit down and forget the entire point. This is not the way of the cross. That's what we learn with Jesus. Therefore, it cannot be the way for us. Most importantly, right now, today, I'm reminded that God works and moves and breathes in each situation around us, often among our mistakes, like Abraham and Sarah's, to bring about his purpose. A God that knows only love. We see glimpses of that God now and then, especially in our fathers. The father that stands in the gap, you know, that's the father, the stepfather that stepped in when the other father stepped out. The one who loves the son in his blood, but in marriage. Or even the stepfather, the father figure that steps in when another father has died. The father that loves their children despite their choices in life. And of course, if I could pick the perfect scripture for Father's Day, it would be the prodigal son and the father who always welcomes his children home. Another shocking element to the story of Hagar and Ishmael is Hagar has some serious moxie with God. She's got some guts. This is her second conversation with God. Before, when she ran away from Sarah, she ran away and God told her she had to go back and she was fearful and God came to her and talked with her and believe it or not, Hagar, an outsider, not one of the promise, gets the privilege of the first one that names God in scripture. The first one that names God. And she's not counted among us. She has moxie. Man, that's guts. And she names him God sees. The God who sees. And I love that. Because the God who sees is so different from all the other gods that they would have worshipped then. It's actually a wonderful truth about monotheism, because when we worship one God, we say the God who sees steps down into this place with us and builds relationship and sees us and loves us and cares for us in this place. It's a name that builds relationship and tells his story to Hagar, just like each one of our names tells our story. A God who understands the struggles that you are going through, that is the God who sees. The God who knows every little sacrifice you make for your family and your children. Every thankless deed of goodness and kindness that you do in the community. We know that God sees, and we celebrate that. We also celebrate that love that we think is just for us seems to go beyond the boundaries that we have set. It always seems that when we start defining ourselves, and that's pretty much what the Old Testament is, defining who the Israelites are in that community of faith and bringing them in that walk with God. But whenever we define who we are, the first thing we usually do is say who we are not. Israelites were God's chosen. The Canaanites weren't. The Samaritans weren't. The Galileans weren't. And that's a really comforting thing to do, because what we get to do is then sit around the campfire and take our scriptures and make us build ourselves up and feel really good about all the things that are in there. And we can and trade stories. And when we do that, our circle becomes so tight and small that we forget that God knows no boundaries. And we forget that God is always calling us to a different place. The Bible contains all the foundational stories. And many of you probably know that this story of Ishmael and Isaac is the foundation of the two faiths. We've got Judaism and Islam. And in these two faiths, we've got Isaac and Ishmael. And going forward into today, that conflict that started right here when Ishmael was blessed continues. And now we have three stories that are interconnected and fighting and not peaceful. And I don't know how to carry that burden. Maybe reinforcing boundaries isn't the way. But once again, I'm reminded of this a lot recently, that God's love knows no boundaries. And even when we must make a mistake, whether it's by accident or because we're just plain broken, human, and mean, God can work through it. And anytime we choose to defy God's word in our lives to benefit us, God still brings us home. That's the rest of the story. And in our broken world, we're too busy reinforcing boundaries instead of opening the circle wide. I'm in the midst of reading a great book called Slings and Arrows, and it's the story of a friend of mine, a very dear family friend, and he works for Equitable Housing in the Native American communities. The statistics are overwhelming. Like 60% of them live below the poverty line. Absolutely devastating. And when he started to go to governments to get tax credits and grants, it was interesting what he heard and didn't hear. This is what he said. Many of you are blind to the obvious, but also blind to our own blindness. Blind to the obvious. We can be blind to the obvious things in our community and in our world that are wrong, because our circle is too small. But it becomes even worse when we are blind to our own blindness, because in doing that, we have defied God's word, willingly chosen our way over his. Don't think it applies to you. Put yourself in the shoes of Abraham and Sarah. Which Hagar and Ishmael do we push out into the wilderness? Let's just open up and let the chips fall where they may. I hear that a lot, and I will confess, in the midst of all of this, I think it too. But in so doing, we're pushing the disabled, the elderly, the at-risk population out into the wilderness on their own. I don't have the answers. But think about that for a little bit. How do your choices in life benefit you at the cost of sending someone else out into the wilderness? And the scripture reminds us that we don't get to choose. Scripture reminds us that God sees all, even the inner workings of our own heart. But it needs to remind us that God, as Father, who sees us all and loves us all as equals, it ought to remind us that we are then ought to love one another as equals. That love is not contingent on the color of our skin, the genes in our bodies, the covenant or the promise, our gender identification, or even our sins in the past. Love from God is not contingent on any of these things. Therefore, our love must not be either. Seems to me that if our good and gracious God on this Father's Day can look down on us and on Hagar and Ishmael in this way, we might need to begin following suit, even when different, drastically as different as Christian, Jew, or Muslim, black or white, straight or gay. We're all loved the exact same, in the same way. Maybe we need to hear that in the story today. The love of the Father, the one who sees and knows everything, good and gracious, loves you beyond anything you can imagine. A Father who loves you so much, he put his Son on the cross so that you might live. A Father that renews us each and every day and sends his Spirit to work among us even when we make mistakes, to bring about his promise and his love and his grace and his kingdom. Though the world may disappoint us, it will. God is constant. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen and amen.
Online via tithely.com
or mail a check to the office.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above the heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
Let us give thanks. Lord, you have blessed us, and today and all days we give thanks for the offerings that are presented, either in money or in deed or in service or in love. Lord, bless each and every one of them. Bless the hands that serve in this community so that your kingdom might be brought to its fullness in this time where we pray, come, Lord Jesus, come. Through your Son, amen. My friends, you are invited to go out into the world and love those that nobody else loves, that only God loves. And that's a challenge. Because just as God the Father sees you and loves you unconditionally, so we are called to love one another. Go in peace. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen and amen.
Good Father.